Old Library presents Letters to a Young Poet by Rainer Maria Rilke. Translated by Joan M. Burnham, with a foreword by Kent Nerburn. Read by Marc Allen.
Letters to a Young Poet, Rainer Maria Rilke. For one human being to love another is perhaps the most difficult task of all, the epitome, the ultimate test. It is that striving for which all other striving is merely preparation. Rainer Maria Rilke. Foreword by Kent Nerburn. All of us who labor in the arts know that it can be a lonely existence. We often find ourselves living a life of solitary dreams, disconnected from others, and driven by a vision that no one else seems to value or share. On some days, this can become overwhelming. We then thirst for a single voice of understanding that will reach into our solitary lives and reassure us that the path we have chosen is worthy, and that the rewards it offers are worth the loneliness it entails. For over 100 years, the voice that has reached out to the aspiring artist with the most clarity and consolation is that of Rainer Maria Rilke. And the place where his voice speaks most clearly is in the transcendently insightful small volume, Letters to a Young Poet. It is a deceptively simple book. It consists of 10 short letters written over a 5-year period to an aspiring young poet named Franz Xaver Kappes. The letters range freely over a variety of subjects, from the dangers of an ironic worldview to the value of faith and the close link between physical and creative ecstasy. But always they come back to the fundamental theme of the aloneness of the creative spirit and the demands it makes upon the lives of those who labor in its service. How is it that such a slim book, written so many years ago in a time so very different from our own, still speaks to us with such authority today? It is easy to point to Rilke's personal genius, and to be sure that plays a part. But if we look past this obvious source, we see that these letters are also the result of a unique conjunction of circumstances that created an almost magical alchemy of thought and feeling. And it is in this magical alchemy that their enduring significance lies. The 3 circumstances that came together to create this alchemy were Rilke's background, his age when he wrote the letters, and the great looming shadow of the sculptor, Auguste Rodin. Rilke came from a background that made him deeply sympathetic to the struggles of anyone striving to be an artist. His father had been a career military man, and had sent his son off to a military boarding school with the intention of training him to be an officer. Rilke, weak of constitution and romantic in temperament, was ill-suited to the physical rigors and severe discipline at the school, and was subject to numerous cruelties by his classmates and teachers. Still, he remained there for 5 formative years of his early adolescence, before, humiliated and physically and spiritually exhausted, he was allowed to return to his native Prague to continue his studies at home. During these 5 trying years, he found his greatest solace and self-expression in the act of writing poetry. It was his only means of shaping what he called the damnation of those years into something of meaning and beauty. So when young Franz Kappes wrote him from that same military academy 12 years later, asking for advice on how to go about living the life of an artist, it touched a chord so deep in Rilke that he could not do otherwise than to write from the most honest place in his heart about the travails and loneliness of the artist's life in a difficult and unsympathetic world. Rilke's age at the time he wrote the letters also had a deep effect on their enduring power. Because of their depth of sentiment and sense of wise detachment, readers often assume that they are the work of an older man looking back on the struggles of his youth. But in fact, these letters were written between Rilke's 28th and 33rd years, years in which he was struggling to find himself artistically, embarking on a marriage, traveling, and meeting life with that freshness that only offers itself to us in the years of early adulthood. He was a grown man in full command of his intellectual powers, but he was also a young man, alive with the passion of youthful discovery. And this gives his insights about life, love, and art, an immediacy and authenticity that can only come from one in whom the very same emotions are alive and present. But it is the great overarching shadow of the French sculptor Auguste Rodin that in the last analysis may prove to be the leavening agent that lifts Rilke's insights from the profound observations of a sensitive and talented young man to the status of timeless utterances about the mysteries of life and the creative process. In 1902, the year before the first of these letters to Franz Kappes, Rilke had come to Paris with the intention of writing a monograph on Rodin. His wife, Clara, a sculptor, was to study with the master, and it was an opportunity for Rilke to observe firsthand the workings of genius, which he so desperately wanted to find in himself. Rodin was everything Rilke was not, confident, robust, sensual, an older man who is secure in his artistic identity and accomplished in his artistic voice. He was an elemental presence with a chiseled brow, a laborer's broad physique, and piercing eyes that seemed to see through the artifice and brittle surface of anyone on whom he chose to focus his attention. He was also a man of few words who worked with unceasing diligence and thought, felt, and spoke not through his words, but through the creations of his hands. As Rilke himself said, Rodin lived inside his art. He did not have to constantly seek it and court it from amongst the intrusive distractions of daily affairs. Contrasted to this was Rilke, the fragile, often sickly young man of delicate sensibilities and uncertain artistic direction, who suffered long periods of artistic aridity and terrifying self-doubt. Slim, slight, easily led astray from his artistic tasks, he lived in constant fear of days when all inspiration failed him, and he was left with nothing but, quote, dead words, corpse heavy. How could he not stand in the presence of Rodin without seeing before him the embodiment of all he dared to be as an artist, as well as a mirror of all his own artistic deficiencies and insecurities? And in fact, this is exactly what happened. In the person of Rodin, Rilke found the model for the artistic authority he wished to possess. And in the letters to young Franz Kappes, he appropriates this air of authority, which he wears like a mantle over the doubts and insecurities that the letters themselves address. He becomes at once the wise and resolved artist he dreams of being, while carrying within him the visceral knowledge of all the struggles the young artist experiences. He manages to claim, in the only way the greatest artists can, the moral authority of that which he observes, while keeping the emotional authenticity of his own feelings. When young Kappes reaches out to him from within the very halls of the military academy that had only 10 years before almost destroyed his own creative spirit, Rilke finds the perfect opportunity to speak with absolute conviction and the deepest passion about the demons and dreams that confront a young artist struggling in an indifferent and uncaring world. He, in effect, writes from the best part of his own artistic vision to the most fragile part of his own artistic self. We as readers can only look on in awe as this brilliant young spirit lays bare the artistic life with a perfect understanding of its deepest desolations and its most exalted ecstasies. Later in his life, Rilke was to write a beautiful verse on the archaic torso of Apollo. standing before the headless Greek sculpture, so radiant with life despite its fragmentary form, he concludes, quote, "For here there is no place that does not see you. You must change your life," unquote. When any of us, struggling with the dreams and demons of the artistic life, reads or hears these 10 brilliant letters on the life of the creative artist, the same shudder of recognition passes through us that passed through Rilke as he stood before the torso of Apollo. We know that from where Rilke writes, there is no place that does not see us. We must change our lives. Kent Nerburn, Bemidji, Minnesota, January 2000. Introduction by Franz Xaver Kepes. It was in the late fall of 1902. I was sitting under ancient chestnut trees in the park of the Military Academy in the new section of Vienna, reading a book. I was so engrossed in the words that I hardly noticed when the learned and beloved chaplain of the academy, the only non-officer on the staff, Professor Horacek, seated himself beside me. He took the volume from my hands, gazed at the cover, and shook his head. "Poems of Rainer Maria Rilke?" he asked thoughtfully. He skimmed the pages, stopping now and then to scan a few verses and gaze pensively into the distance. Finally, with a nod, he said, "Well, Rene Rilke, my student, has turned into a poet after all." It was then I learned about the thin, pale boy who had been sent by his parents more than 15 years ago to the military academy to become a commissioned officer. At that time, Horacek had been chaplain there. He still remembered the former student clearly. He described him as a quiet, serious, highly gifted young man who liked to keep to himself and who patiently endured the stress of dormitory life. After the fourth year, he moved ahead with the others to the military academy at Maritsch, Weisskirchen. There, however, he apparently lacked the necessary endurance for the regimen, so his parents took him out of the school and allowed him to continue his studies at home in Prague. How the events of his life unfolded after that, Professor Horacek could not say. After our talk, I decided to send Rainer Maria Rilke my poetic attempts and to ask him for his judgment. I was hardly 20, not quite at the threshold of a career against which I felt an inner revolt. I hoped to receive solace and understanding, if from anyone, from the author of the book In Celebration of Myself. Without actually intending it, I found myself writing letters to accompany my verses. In them I revealed my innermost self unreservedly as never before and never since to another person. Many weeks passed before an answer to the first letter came. The blue seal revealed the postmark from Paris. It weighed heavy in my hand and revealed on the envelope the same clear, beautiful, and confident handwriting as that in the contents of the letter, from the first line to the last. Thus began my regular correspondence with Rainer Maria Rilke, which lasted until 1908. Gradually it became less frequent, and finally stopped because life forced me off into paths from which the poet's gentle, warm, and touching concern would have liked to protect me. But that is unimportant. Important alone are the 10 letters, important for the understanding of the world in which Rainer Maria Rilke lived and worked, important also for the many who are growing and evolving now and shall in the future. When a truly great and unique spirit speaks, the lesser ones must be silent. Franz Xaver Kepes, Berlin, June 1929. The first letter. I know of no other advice than this. Go within and scale the depths of your being from which your very life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.